Speakcies.
Hello and welcome to season 5, episode 138 of Origin of Speakcies, the show where we talk about words, phrases, and other stuff. My name is Scott. I'm here as always with my friend Steve, and we have got a fun show tonight. We're going to do a couple idioms, and a very special guest will be here, and that is my dad, known by some as Big Mike.
Yeah.
And you'll want to stick around for it because you never know what's going to come out of his yeah. mouth. He's old.
And you might learn another nickname for him too.
That's right. That's right. There may be something beyond just Big Mike. So, all right. First one we're going to do tonight is one that I cannot believe we haven't done, Steve. It's weird how, like, I'll be talking to you and say, I think we've done all the idioms, right. Which I know is not true, but I'm like, I can't think of one. And then all of a sudden I'll remember we've not done chip on your shoulder. And chip on your shoulder to me is a great one to do because I grew up not having any idea what it meant. I mean, I kind of, you know, again, like all these, you kind of pick it up through right. context, but I mean, what I would just envision was like a Lay's potato chip on a shoulder. And I didn't understand why that would make anyone grumpy. Yeah. So hopefully we'll figure that out today. What about you, Steve? Chip on your shoulder? Is that something that you...
It's one that I've heard a lot, and I kind of know it when I hear it, and I know what it means. But it's one that if you think about a lot, it's never made sense to me. Like your analogy of like having a chip on your shoulder, I've always thought of like having like a small stick on your shoulder or just something. It just, it seems odd, but I bet you there's a good story behind it. And if not, I'll call you out. If you tell the story and it's terrible,
that would be awesome.
Then you will have a chip on your shoulder against me.
Yeah, I would love that. That would be a great twist to the show is that we just start getting real confrontational. Yeah. That was the worst, you know, that was terrible. Okay. But I don't think it'll be that way. Cause I actually think this one is quite interesting. And, just a little preview, I get to go back into the wonderful world of Quora, which I haven't done in a while and it's worth it.
Yeah.
So the first one, again, chip on your shoulder. The first thing I wanted to do was I've started doing this thing where instead of just going directly to sources, I'll just Google the term because I want to see what's the first thing that comes up because I don't want to do a show and then realize like a movie just came out with that term and there's something interesting. Have you ever heard of Rod Wave?
Rod Wave. Is that a person?
Yeah, it's a person. It's kind of a great name because I feel like I like when names can be a verb as well. Yeah. Like, and Wave, Rod Wave, I believe is his real name. Okay. This might ring a bell. His first album debuted a couple years ago. It's called Ghetto Gospel.
Oh, no, still not ringing a bell.
No. But I believe he would be a big fan of the new catchphrase that's sweeping the nation.
That's what I'm talking about.
Exactly. Yes. But anyway, I have to bring it up. He has a song called Chip on My Shoulder, and it's a pretty good song, actually. Mm-hmm. A little more auto-tune than I tend to like, but it has over 11 million views on YouTube, and it's kind of a decent song. So Chip on My Shoulder, great song by Ghetto Gospel's the album. Check it out. So getting to the term itself, Merriam-Webster defines chip on my shoulder or chip on your shoulder or chip on one's shoulder, which is probably how I'm going to say it from here on out, is an angry or unpleasant attitude or way of behaving caused by a belief that one has been treated unfairly in the past. Does that kind of ring true to kind of how you think of it as well?
It rings true, the first part of it. I didn't think of it in the context of being angry or upset because of you being wronged. That to me is a new wrinkle.
Same here. When I read that, but then when I read it, I was like, you know, it makes sense. I can sort of see this. So I started thinking about like, who are some people that not like people we know or anything, but who are some maybe famous people that you could say have a chip on their shoulder? And one of the things too, I think we can talk about here at some point is it a good or a bad thing? But let's reserve that to the end of the,
Is it
a positive or a negative? Because as I was reading through definitions and articles and Quora, you know, I would say that the majority of the opinions were that having a chip on one shoulder is a negative thing. But I think that there are times where maybe it can be a good thing. So mm-hmm. you and I have talked about this a lot. I think on the podcast, we've certainly brought it up a couple times, which is Michael Jordan. We talk about Michael Jordan a lot. And in the context of sports, you do hear a lot, like this guy plays with a chip on his shoulder. Going to your point about the twist with being wronged in the past, it kind of mm-hmm. makes sense if you think about, I was thinking about Michael Jordan as like the premier person that sort of lived like he had a chip on his shoulder, at least mm-hmm. played that way. So a couple examples, obviously, you know, he famously got cut from his varsity team. What they don't tell you is, I think he was only in ninth grade or something. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't like, I mean, most ninth graders don't make the team. Right. I understand he's Michael Jordan, but this is how he chose to take it personal mm-hmm. and get a chip on his shoulder. Right. I'm sure you probably know this, but listeners, you know, when he went to UNC, that people kept saying, you got to try to be better than Buzz Peterson, which I don't know. I've never heard of him other than, I guess he played for that UNC team. And so that was his big motivator. And then one of my favorite parts of the documentary, Bulls documentary, The Last Dance, is when they show this guy, I think his name, I may have written this down wrong, but I believe his name was Labrador Smith. Okay. That can't be right. Labrador. But anyway, a player that we've never heard of anymore. He had a career game against Michael Jordan. He scored 37 points. The next game they played, Michael Jordan said, I'm going to score 37 in the first half on this guy. Now, he had leaked to, not Ahmad Rashad, but David Aldridge, I think he had said mm-hmm. after the game, this guy, whatever his name, Labrador Smith, said, good game, Mike. After he had, now here's the thing. Jordan had already scored 25 points in that game. So it's not mm-hmm. like he didn't score.
Right.
But he was playing defense on this guy, and this guy ate him up. This is the best game he ever had in his life. Mm. So Jordan comes out. He scores 36 in the first half. He doesn't get to 37, and he's still pissed because he's like, one free throw short. But almost matched his thing. And then later, it wasn't like, I don't think it was right after the game. It's like years later, mm-hmm. he admitted that he made that up. That the guy never said anything to him.
Right.
So why do I take all the time to tell that long story? Because I like talking about Michael Jordan, but also because I think it's a pretty good illustration of somebody with a chip on their shoulder. Yeah. I don't know if anybody jumps to mind for you. I didn't like ask you to prepare anything, but mm-hmm. I mean, what do you think of when you think about somebody? Is there any famous person? Is it mostly just athletes or?
I would say a lot of times it's athletes. I want to say there was some sort of origin story a little bit with, the founder of Microsoft, Bill Gates, of him kind of being the nerd that was put down and took that, you know, took it personally a little bit like Michael Jordan, but used it to inspire him. You hear, I think, a lot of those in kind of origin stories of people. If no one wants just to hear some guy thought up an idea, you know, you want to see your hero take a journey to fight back against something. So it kind of goes into the mythos that we all like to hear, like with Michael Jordan, we like to hear that there's a story behind some random game. And out of all the games that he played, you know, the 34th game of whatever season that to no one else really doesn't matter. But to him, you know, there's mm-hmm. a story with that. And that's something I've always liked about people. I've got half of it, right? I've taken lots of stuff personal, but I've never used it to inspire me to do anything better. And I think that's the other thing I like about that story. I think it's important too. In the realm of athletics, you're able to take that and use it and do something specific with it. You know, if you're playing somebody, if you need that extra edge to get a chip on your shoulder, to personify who you're going against, how that works in day-to-day life, you know, how you send an email to somebody. I could see how that also can bleed. That can be a double-edged sword. It's like how people always with tempers, we'll talk about Jesus was angry in the temple.
Right.
But he did some other stuff too. You know what I mean? That wasn't like his whole, the whole thing around him. And that can be an excuse, I think, sometimes.
Absolutely. Those are some excellent points. That's some good stuff because I've been trying to work this out in my head and you just really made a lot of sense. Like I think situationally it can make sense. And you mentioned Bill Gates and I guess a lot of these guys, I mean, I guess in some sense, I thought you were going to say Steve Jobs because even Steve Jobs, there were points in his life where I think really high performing individuals sometimes do need something to, they need some juice to kind of really motivate them, because if they're already dominating so thoroughly, they take a little slight, okay, this is what I need to get through. But to your point, if your outlook on life is just that I'm going to take it personal, or I'm going to have a chip on my shoulder, I'd say the majority of people don't turn out to be Bill Gates or Michael Jordan.
Right.
They're just people that are bitter.
And unhappy. Yeah. And end up wearing bandanas on podcasts.
No, I don't think of you in that way. Well, there have been a couple of times in my life where I have taken something personal. I mean, I wish I did it more, but there have been a couple of times where I was like, oh, okay. Yeah. And then I was motivated because I was angry, or I did have that chip on my shoulder. But let's talk about, though, where it came from. It's kind of cool. And I mean, I definitely at a certain point figured that, I knew it wasn't a Lay's potato chip, but I still didn't understand. The other thing I used to think about was, like, are you mad because you have a chip on your shoulder in the same way that, like, you get a chip in a ashtray or something? You know what I mean? Like a little chip that's like maybe
stone you're in your shoe, something to agitate you and keep you angry.
Right. And that was sort of what I just thought it was for the longest time, to the extent I gave it any thought. Because a lot of these idioms, at a certain point, it doesn't matter, like, when you use it, where it came from. I mean, this is fun, it's what we do on the podcast, but like, you've got the connotation that you need. Mm-hmm. It's almost like, okay, I don't know the etymology, but I don't know the etymology of a lot of words. Almost every word I use, I just need to know the connotation, and we need to have an agreed definition of what it is. So I found a couple. Now, I will go ahead and tell you that when I looked at the worldwide words entry, which I always kind of do, I do on every single one just to see, it was great. And I'll tell you what he said at the end, but he, the worldwide words, David Quinion basically said, for once we know what this is. So it's going to be satisfying, but I'm going to tell you what I found on Quora, and I want you to give your thoughts. And if you have a guess of which one of these three,
sure,
it could be, or maybe it's none of these three. It's Quora after all, or Quora. I don't even know, but probably Quora. All right, let's start with the first one. So the question was on Quora, you know, where does a chip on one's shoulder come from? Simple as that. And someone, and by the way, one of the main reasons I love Quora, I mean, there are many reasons, but I am almost to the point where I wonder if, and I'm actually being serious, and I want to know what you think. I think it's possible that some of these sites, Quora being one of them, may be some people on there, but maybe supplemented by AI and fake. Do you know what I'm saying? Because
I think it would be a good fertile ground to practice. It'd be like the minor leagues. Like, before you're going to get on Twitter, Facebook and manipulate people, do a little bit, you know, face some competition on Quora and see if you can outdo them.
It's just because it's like, there's a similarity in the ridiculousness of not only the stuff that gets typed sometimes, but also like the names and they put their titles afterwards. And there's just this uncanny valley situation where I'm like, yes, by all accounts, this seems like a human wrote this, but it weirdly doesn't. So let's start with the first one. This is David Thomas. Nothing weird about that name, other than it's just a plain
way
name.
Too plain. Yeah.
Very and obvious. He and his, like, you know, everyone kind of puts what their profession is or who they are, what their credentials is. His is former ensign, which I had to look that up, ENSIGN, and it said like the lowest member of the military. So it's kind of like a, I don't know, whatever you would call it, you know, just a, not an, you know, anyway, just whatever, just the private or whatever. And I'm going to read his, and some of these go a little long, but just stick with me. So here's David Thomas, former ensign, answering the question. A chip on one's shoulder can mean anything. He has an axe to grind. She has an axe to grind. People believe that Cain had a chip on his shoulder, but Abel was the one with a chip on his shoulder. Adam had a chip on his shoulder, and Eve had a chip on her shoulder. Only they did not know they had a chip on their shoulder. They did not even know that they had an axe to grind. Even legislators, politicians, judges, attorneys, doctors, priests, pastors, preachers, rabbis, and reverends, and then in parentheses, the whole clergy.
Oh, good. In case you weren't sure.
Right. Soldiers and police officers walk with chips on their shoulders. They wielded axes to bolster the chips on their shoulders. Read the news, listen to the news, with or without provocation, those people have chips on their shoulders. So when people believe violence and brutality and perversion and corruption should be labeled as senseless, the causes are that people have chips on their shoulders and axes, weapons in parentheses, to grind. Mm-hmm. Be warned and be careful. So I will tell you, I took a, there's a whole nother paragraph in the middle that I took out.
Thank you.
It doesn't really say where it came from, and it right. makes absolutely no sense, but it's one of the three options that you have.
Yeah.
Are you still there? Are you okay?
Yeah. I mean, it's bad. It's bad internet writing. Someone's waxing very eloquent, or some machine was waxing or trying to wax eloquent, I guess.
Waculent would be an awesome word, by the way. I'm writing that down. This was either written by, so it's obviously not this one. This was either written by, I mean, a drunk person, I don't think would write this, like an insane person or a computer, or I guess the third option is always like some sort of troll. Like why? I just think it's probably a nuts person, but had to read that one. Now let's get to the second option. This is by Chris Beavis. And I swear this is not the first Beavis mm-hmm. that we've had on Quora, but I can't prove it. Chris Beavis, technologist, physicist, and systems engineer, writes, it means to hold a grudge or grievance, particularly feeling undervalued or disrespected and behaving badly because of it. As for the origin, there was an old custom of putting a chip of wood on your shoulder and daring someone to knock it off in order to start a fight. He says this idiom traces its roots back to a custom that was known in North America since the early 19th century. The New York newspaper Long Island Telegraph reported on May 20th, 1830, quote, when two churlish boys were determined to fight, a chip would be placed on the shoulder of one and the other demanded to knock it off at his peril. A similar notion is mentioned in the issue of Onondaga Standard of Syracuse, New York, on December 8th, 1830, quote, he waylay me, said I, the mean sneaking fellow. I am only afraid that he will sue me for damages. Oh, if I could only get him to knock a chip off my shoulder and so get around the law, I would give him one of the soundest thrashings he ever had. Okay.
That's I like that one a lot better. And it's tough though. If you put churlish in something, I'm going to like it. That's a fun
it's
word.
Great. It's great. I will move on to the last one. Beavin Audstone, or maybe it's Bevan, but mm-hmm. we just said the last guy's name was Beavis.
Beavis, this
is
right. Bevan.
Again, I don't, this is the times where I'm like, we're in a weird civil simulation. Mm-hmm. And he, instead of putting any credentials or anything or a title of what he does, he just put words are everything. So here we go. Hang with me is the last one. A chip on the shoulder comes from the ancient right of shipwrights within the Royal Navy dockyards to take home a daily allowance of offcuts of timber, even if good wood was cut up for this purpose. The privilege was installed before 1660, but by 1756, the privilege had been abused and was costing the taxpayer too much in lost timber for warship repair and construction. The decision was made by the Royal Navy Board to limit the quantity a shipwright could carry home, and a warrant was issued to the Royal Dockyards to reduce the quantity of chips by ordering shipwrights to carry their bundles under their arms instead of on their shoulders, as one could not carry as much timber in this fashion, right? So if you got under your arms, yeah. Oh, let me just keep reading.
Yeah.
One day at 12 o'clock, some few of the workmen, about 150, came up first to the gate without any chips. Afterwards, about 20 more came and lowered their chips agreeable to the board's warrant. Then came John Miller, shipwright, about 30 feet before the main body of the people on which the master shipwright ordered him to lower his chips. He answered he would not. With that, the master shipwright took hold of him and said, you should. Miller replied, are the chips not mine? I will not lower them. Immediately, the main body pushed on with their chips on their shoulders, crowded and forced the master shipwright and first assistant through the gateway, and out of the yard, they all gave three huzzas. So your options are the nuts guy talking about Adam and Eve and axes to grind, mm-hmm. the guy saying that it was a child's game where you would tell someone to put a piece of wood on your shoulder and knock it off, or, and also a way to get around the law.
Yeah.
Or three, the Royal Navy without cat of nine tails this time. Any thoughts?
So I want to dismiss the first one. I'm eliminating just because it was way too much wind in that person's story and definition. The second one I'm a little biased towards because it has churlish in it. I just love that word. The third one, I don't like these ones that have like the story that everyone knows. And there's this thing that people are doing, like the one about, there's some other one about, I think it was counting your eggs before they're hatched, that people are getting assigned to war and being given a chicken. Yeah. But I do like that it has the Navy involvement. So if I got to pick one, I'm going to go with number two. Based on the word churlish.
Yeah. Well, your instincts were right. Churlish is, that quote is mentioned in every article you're going to find. You find like two or three quotes going back to 1830, where this came around the time that this was in print. And everyone uses the churlish one. And as did I, as did Beavis, because it is a great word.
Good job, Beavis.
Great job, Beavis. So yeah, that's true. That's what it was. You know, there are a lot of, it's nothing more than, you read other countries did this as well. It kind of, but it is an American term, and it didn't show up. By the way, the thing about the ships being, now that is true in the sense that they did call them chips. They actually did let them take them. And this whole story is actually based in truth. Mm-hmm. However, this is all set about 200 plus years prior to the first time you ever hear anybody using chip on your shoulder in the sense that we use it today. It really is just, it would either be a chip, they would use other things like stones. Mm-hmm. And essentially, like, if you were walking around with one, you're saying, like, I know that in Canada, it was like a big deal. It was like, I dare you.
Yeah.
And the idea of, you can't be sued if, so like, let's say somebody did you wrong. You go attack them and kick their butt. You get sued. I mean, that happened now, or you'd be put in jail. Nowadays, you probably have to have some sort of written agreement. But back then, it was like, the guy, what are you going to do? He knocked the chip off my shoulder. So that is it. I said there are many things that could be knocked off your shoulder. And I'm going to show you something I found during my research right here as I wrap up this segment. I do want to say first, though, that I wanted to quote, because there's no reason for me to even go any further or like read World Wide Words' account, because it's exactly what Beavis said. And, but I did like that Quinion said when he was asked the question, he said, very occasionally someone asks about a phrase for which a good explanation exists. This is one of those rare cases. Let us pause a moment to celebrate. So there, let's pause a moment to celebrate, because it is rare. It is rare. But as I said, there was another one, and there was another thing you could knock off. Now I'm going to pull up a video here. So hopefully you're watching this, people, on YouTube. And if you don't already watch us on YouTube, you can look us up on YouTube or go to our website and we have a link to it, or our Instagram at Speakcies. And you can go to our link tree and you'll find all sorts of stuff, including the YouTube. So Steve, Robert Conrad is someone who I don't know that I could tell you like what he has done in his career. The only thing I remember him from is like Battle of the TV Network Stars or whatever. Right. I'm assuming you know what he was in, but
I kind of don't, as much as I know a lot of worthless stuff. He just has one of those generic 70s guys names that I can guess he was a white guy and he probably played a detective at some point.
Exactly. I was thinking he had to be, I'm like, he wasn't in Hunter. He wasn't in, you know, I'm like, he had to be in some show. I guess Hunter was 80s, right? But like, or maybe it was 70s and 80s. But I wanted to show this because I don't know anything about Robert Conrad, but I want to. Let's just watch it.
I dare you to knock this off. I dare you to compare anybody's batteries, anybody's, with alkaline power cells and try to beat them for long life. You know what? You can't. When you want long-lasting energy, you can't buy a longer-lasting all-purpose power system than gold, red, and black alkaline power cells from EverReady. The power cell that dares to compare. Yeah. I dare you.
if you're just listening to this, if you're wondering, he does have an alkaline battery, an EverReady battery on his shoulder. I hope you enjoyed that as much as I did, Steve. And it makes me want to know more about Robert Conrad. The intensity that he had in that commercial was incredible.
Especially for a 50-year-old man on a dirt bike.
Well, right. It had me with the dirt bike. I literally, you start it and that's reason to subscribe to our YouTube alone is to see Robert Conrad on a dirt bike. It's incredible. He's very handsome too.
He is a good looking man.
Stares into the camera and dares you to knock off that battery. They don't make them like that anymore. They're too warm. Commercials are too warm and fuzzy now.
Yeah.
So anyway, check that one out. And with that, we'll move on to new slang. Steve, I believe you have some for us today.
I do. I have a wonderful new slang for us. But before we get into that, there's an article I read in the last week that I couldn't let get past me. In the past, we've discussed how PETA periodically will put out some press release of something just so stupid and vapid that they want you to talk about it and say how dumb it is. And, you know, it's on purpose. We fall for it pretty much every time because we talk about it and they get promoted. So I've noticed, unfortunately, an organization I had a little bit more respect for, NPR, has started doing the same thing. So it's an article that came out recently that you've probably already heard about. The title of the article is, "Which Skin Color Emoji Should You Use? The Answer Can Be More Complex Than You Think."
Of course.
So to if you couldn't tell, the article is about the use of color regarding people's thumbs up in their emoji repertoire. So a couple things. First of all, no, the answer is not more complex. Use whatever color you want. It's America. Second, and you can back this up. I, for years, have only used two emojis. One, black thumbs up for hashtag diversity. I think I've been more liberal than NPR has been on this. I've been doing that for a long time. And two, an eggplant because it looks like a penis. And I communicate solely with those two.
Yeah, I will vouch for you. Yeah. I've never seen you use another emoji other than those two. And you use those two very liberally. And so how did you take this news that it's complex? And did you even read the article? Or were you just
I read it a few times. And I'm not going to do the same hot take everyone else has. You've already, you know, you can guess it's as stupid as it sounds. It needlessly interjects race into something. Somehow it has three authors. It's all pathetic, but
to be represented every color of the thumb.
Yeah. Dumb people from across the spectrum, but I'm going to take a different spin on it. So the focus of the article is how there's multiple colors. I believe five on Apple's iOS that you can use for a thumbs up. But you know what? There's only one eggplant that you can use. And that's what I think is where they've buried the lead and gone wrong.
That's a great point.
What about hashtag diversity for eggplants? So I spent some time this afternoon, and when China or our government ever taps my computer, it'll be an interesting day for them as I was the things I was Googling and trying to find on my Mac. But essentially, there's one eggplant. After all these years, and it's altered slightly. But is there a chance for different colors of eggplants?
Sizes,
especially.
They correspond with the colors, maybe?
Yes. Veins. I mean, there's a lot of different things that could be done with this.
I agree.
And so whereas everyone else is looking at this article and probably focusing on how stupid it is and lacking, what a horrible life these people must have that had to write this.
Oh my gosh.
Or spend their time thinking about it. Yeah. You know, what a waste of air and resources that they are.
I just hope people don't take it seriously. But anyway, sorry. Please go ahead.
Well, I took it seriously.
Yes, you did. You took it personally.
I took it personally. And I'm not just going to just rant about it. Well, actually, I probably just am. But maybe this is the birth of a movement. Maybe I need to track down one of these authors and start to discuss with them the eggplant and what they're going to do to make some diversity with that. You know, I proudly identify as a Belgian Mongolian. And if you don't believe me, go to speakcies.com/store. where you can buy a Belgian Mongolian Pride t-shirt. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we're always coming up with new ideas for shirts. Maybe I'm going to need to use shirts to call for some more eggplant diversity.
Why no black eggplant? Why no white eggplant? I like it. Why no little yellow eggplant? I mean,
why not? Where's the veins?
Hashtag where's the veins?
Yeah.
You know, listen, what I've learned over the last like 5 years is you could get some traction with that. There would be people who would be just like you, righteously angry,
mm-hmm.
and would follow you down that road because there's not enough representation with the purple eggplant. I agree.
Yeah.
And hashtag where's the veins. So that's now, did they, I mean, you don't have to, if this is just getting us off the main topic, don't worry about it. Why is it complicated? I assume that they come out saying that you just shouldn't use anyone except for whatever you identify with or whatever. But like,
well, I think the point is, and we've talked about formulaic things on Quora.
Yeah.
There's the formulaic thing where basically it's going to end up being racist. So what by saying it's complicated gives the three authors another few lines before they call it racist.
Yeah. Good point. All right. You ready for some new slang?
I'm ready for some new
slang. Let's do it.
New slang when you notice the stride.
So this new slang has been on my radar for a long time,
mm-hmm.
which probably means it's really old slang, but that's not the point. The point of this is for me to go out there and to say, find some term that I awkwardly will navigate and share with the public its origin. However, this one has been a little bit closer to my heart because it involves the greatest professional wrestler of all time, the Nature Boy, Ric Flair.
Oh,
so
Ric Flair, he hasn't been in the show since season two, I don't think.
It's been a while, and it's a shame because he's mm-hmm. the Nature Boy, Ric Flair, and he should be with us all the time. He's always in my heart.
Yeah.
But now he's on my podcast. So today's new slang is the term drip.
Yes.
So starting from dictionary.com in their new slang section.
They ripped us off.
I think they did, or else I just misremembered something. And if it's misinformation, again, YouTube, here, I'll sum them. Ivermectin. They'll come here and they'll fix it.
Yeah.
So back to dictionary.com. If you have the drip, it means you have swagger, especially in how you look. You're hot. You're cool. You're on point. You've got the sauce. You're, you know, insert awesome slang term here. That's dictionary.com's writing, by the way.
Yeah.
So
it rolled really nicely off your tongue. That was good.
It did. I think just I got the passion from thinking about the lack of hashtag diversity from NPR on their eggplant coverage. So continuing, drip appears to be a metaphor. You're dripping with money, designer clothes, or confidence. Or as Bruno Mars sang on his January 2018 Finesse remix with Cardi B, we out here dripping in finesse. It don't make no sense.
I have to tell you, I have to admit, I love that song. Mm-hmm. And I used to play it all the time as a DJ. I had to finally decide I wasn't going to just not like Bruno Mars on principle.
Right.
You know what I mean? Cause you go, well, he took essentially like Michael Jackson and a couple other artists and threw them in a blender and then came out with the sound, but he writes some good songs. Finesse, Drippin' and Finesse. Good song. So sorry, carry on.
I will carry on. So continuing on from dictionary.com, they state its origin is disputed, including among rappers. They cite a hip-hop blog called Hip Hop DX, claiming the word originates in 2000s Atlanta rap, and then also says it might come from a TV show from the late 2000s called Zoe 101 that introduced dripping as slang for cool.
I wish they were dipping on whatever Zoe 101 is.
Yeah.
I'm sure it would be comical to have them dipping.
Yeah. Or dripping. Or whichever. Or dripping. But so at that point, though, in the same way when you read in Quora, you just see something and you see a pattern or something that makes you think this isn't the truth. I was having the same feeling about what dictionary.com was giving us. So I decided to go to a better resource, genius.com. So from their history of drip entitled What Does Drip Mean? Drip isn't a new slang term, but has experienced a renaissance in hip-hop over the past few years. With drip coming to the forefront of slang, the debate has turned to its meaning, origins, and who made it popular. To explain the rise of drip, Genius took a dive into our lyrics data, and here they come up with a rapper I've actually never heard of before by the name of Sauce Walker.
Yeah, I haven't heard of Sauce Walker either.
Yeah. So, and I did check, he is not a Cuomo, just to be clear on that.
Yeah.
So one of the things I like about Genius is they actually have data they can go back into. So they say drip was mentioned over 2,000 times in hip hop songs in the year 2018 alone.
That's a lot of dripping. That's a lot of dripping. Yeah, That's a lot.
So they give a couple examples. Gunna and Little Babies drip too hard.
Okay, I think I've heard that.
Mm-hmm. Cardi B's drip.
I don't listen to Cardi B. So
yeah. And they said this amount equals the 2018 amount equals 195% increase compared to 2017.
Okay.
And it's also quadruple the times that drip was used in 2016.
Okay. Yeah. So it's interesting that you... Is it okay if I interject a little thought here? Because yes. You said you're going to do drip, and I was glad because the last we did swag, or you did swag on the last episode. And actually, now that I think of it, that wasn't a new slang though, was it? That was just a term you did. And that's right. And that's actually appropriate because I didn't bring this up during the show, but like I kept thinking about I watch Reds baseball. Because I'm a winner in life. Mm. I watch baseball almost every night. Cincinnati Reds baseball. So anyway, Barry Larkin, Hall of Famer, our old shortstop. He used to – so one of the guys on the broadcast would always go, oh, man, you dressed up. Now, you know the old, like, the banter they have in the commentators will be like, oh, that tie looks great tonight, you know. And they'll kind of tease each other. And he every time one of the guys would say swag, Barry Larkin would say, stop saying swag. The kids don't say swag anymore. They say drip. So when you said drip, I was like, perfect. It is sort of the new swag, I think, especially as you're pointing out how it really jumped up in, and I know we're not to the point where we say whether we like it or not, but I will, if you don't mind, I'm going to go ahead and say, I generally can't stand this word because it's like, do we need another meaning for the word drip? However, when we're recording this right after Valentine's Day, and I had I had dinner with my daughter. We always do something on Valentine's Day. Mm-hmm. And I had given her a ring and a necklace. And she put them on and she's like, I love them. You know, she gave me a hug. And then she's like, and then she said, how did she put it? She basically goes, I'm dripping, or I'm full of drip right now, or something, whatever she said. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't believe she said that. And I was like, it must be the new cool thing. So because my daughter has used it recently, and it was really funny and cute when she said it, I will say I like it for that reason. But generally speaking, not a fan. And I'm wondering, though, you said it kind of peaked in 2018. Is it getting replaced by anything, or is it still hot?
If it is, we'll know in about 10 years based on the way I stay on top of things. But to continue from genius.com, they credit it to the aforementioned Sauce Walker. And quoting from them, dating back to their 2014 Sauce Mania mixtape, Walker and his Sauce Family crew have used it as a derivative of sauce. And I'm quoting here from one of Walker Sauce's songs, Flava in Ya Ear. Walker raps, talking Flava in Ya Ear right here. I know you hear me, Mother Scratcher. Splash, drip, drop.
First of all, Flava in Your Ear is a Craig Mack song.
Yeah. So we'll have to discuss that at another time.
And rappers don't do covers, do they? I've never heard a rap cover.
I've heard a few, but not many. It's not very common.
Yeah.
So as we get on with this, it's one that I kind of came down to like two reasons I liked it or didn't like it. So going for the why I don't like it, other than the obvious, I was like, why does it always, every time I saw it, I just felt distasteful. There's something in the back of my head.
And then
it came back to me. I'd say the primary reason I don't like it is it's also been used as a nickname for gonorrhea.
Yes.
So whereas the clap is pretty famous as a nickname for gonorrhea, drip is too, as apparently it's a symptom.
I was thinking that earlier, and I wasn't sure. I wasn't sure it was gonorrhea, but I was like, I know drip is an STD thing. Like, I don't know anything about those. Okay. But anyway, there's nothing good. That you bring up a good point. Not just the fact that it's that. I mean, what else in life is a drip a good thing ever? Mm-hmm. You hear a drip in your faucet, that's bad. Well, I guess technically maybe you could find some positive, but it's really hard to think of. I mean, dripping is usually your nose is dripping. Mm-hmm. You got gonorrhea. I don't know what's actually dripping there, but.
So that actually is a very good way to put it. And I will show you why I like it. And I can modify drip with two words, Ric Flair.
Really?
So several years ago, there's a song called Ric Flair Drip.
Oh, that's right.
By rapper Offset.
Yep.
He made a video for it. Ric Flair, the Nature Boy himself, appeared in the video. Apparently, one of the times that Ric Flair got married, he walked down the aisle to it.
What?
Yes. So I was going to say, as we kind of wrap up, I was going to say I like it despite its kind of soiled association with gonorrhea. Ric Flair was going to push it over the top. But the combination of Barry Larkin and your daughter.
Yeah.
You know, you combine Barry Larkin, your daughter, and Ric Flair.
And Ric Flair.
That's a pretty unstoppable trio there. So I'm going to say I like drip.
I like drip too for those reasons. And Ric Flair's your guy, but you have converted me. I'll watch Ric Flair, listen to Ric Flair, anything having to do with Ric Flair at any time. So we're giving it two thumbs up.
That's our new slang.
All right, Steve-O, we're going to do one more here before we go and before we talk to our special guest, my dad. And appropriately, it is chip off the old block. So this one is not that complicated, and I'm not going to be reading long, insane things from the internet or anything like that. This is going to be a fun little short one here, like my eggplant emoji would be. But anyway, chip off the old block. So what's interesting about this one, the obvious is that it means that you are, it's kind of like saying like the acorn doesn't fall too far from the tree, or it just means that you're like your parents, or generally speaking, it's usually used for a dad. It means that you're like your dad. According to Phrase Finder, they put the definition as a person or thing that derives from the source of parentage, or the source or parentage. So it doesn't necessarily have to be parentage. But what is the block and what does it mean? So there are at least three variants of this phrase. So it wasn't always chip off the old block. The earliest form of the phrase is chip of the same block. This is somebody that's a chip of the same block. And that kind of, you can kind of make sense to that, right? Like, you guys are pretty much identical. You come from the same stock, so to speak. Mm-hmm. And the block, you know, we don't know. It could have been stone or wood. It doesn't really matter, but it goes back pretty far. Matter of fact, this is a concept that's gone back really far. But at least 1621, and that's the first time we see it specifically put that way in writing, Bishop Robert Sanderson, in one of his sermons, said, "Am I not a child of the same Adam, a chip off the same block, a chip of the same block with him?" So that's that use of a chip of the same block. Then my boy, John Milton, I love Milton. We haven't talked about him.
Not enough.
He does a variation shortly after that. And are you ready for this, Steve? Speaking of drip, where do you hear the name of this book? Okay.
I'm ready.
It might be the best, and I'm building it up, but you'll see why. In a book entitled An Apology Against a Modest Confutation of the Animadversions Upon the Remonstrant Against Smectimnus. In that book, An Apology Against a Modest Confutation of the Animadversions Upon the Remonstrant Against Smectinus, he says, "How well dost thou now appear to be a chip of the old block?"
Wow.
So So, I mean, that's one of the longer ones we've had.
That's that. And I believe Schmectellus is also a symptom of gonorrhea.
Good. Yeah. What was great was, as I was reading this article where they were talking about this, actually it was Phrase Finder. I saw it and I was like, oh, I can't wait to read this to Steve. I mean, I can't pronounce a third of the words, but this is going to be awesome. And the first time I've seen this in like Phrase Finder, one of these, he said, I really just wanted to put this quote because of this magnificently long title. And I was like, even they're impressed at Steve's going to love this. So slight difference there. The only difference with that one is instead of chip of the same block, it's a chip of the old block. Mm. So that changes a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
But both of those versions refer to a block that someone could go back to and make another thing from that or person from that. And then it stayed for a long time of rather than off until the 19th century, where it became a chip off the old block as we know it now. And it meant especially being looking like your father or having characteristics of your father. The earliest reference is in the Ohio newspaper, the Athens Messenger, June 1870, where it says, the children see their parents' double dealings, see their want of integrity, and learn them to cheat. Learn them instead of teach them. The child is too often a chip off the old block.
Mm.
So there you have it. Chip off the old block. And speaking of, now it's time for a conversation with our special guest, my dad. All right, our guest today is my dad, Mike. Dad, thanks for joining us.
Hey, it's my honor.
And you know Steve.
Yeah, my neighbor.
I do. I know. Good to see you, Steve.
And you know,
you too.
You know we have a podcast together and everything, right?
Oh, yeah. I've listened every day.
Really? What's your favorite episode? Don't answer that.
I think it's the one about the raccoons.
He does listen.
By the way, I saw a raccoon during daylight today. That's not a joke.
Well, that is kind of odd.
I had Henrico animal control dialed up, but it wandered out of my yard. Whenever you see a raccoon at 7 in the morning, and it looked like it had had a rough night too. It didn't look like it had just like accidentally ended up where it was, whatever had happened to it.
Right.
Probably involved disease and filth and sickness.
Yeah. There's some living under my shed. I'm just leaving them there. For now. Yeah.
Okay. Well, if you want to address that, you just let me know off air. I'll see what I can do to help you out.
Okay. Appreciate it.
Yeah. Don't incriminate yourself here. Are you allowed to murder raccoons, or is that, I know some things you can't kill. You're not supposed to anymore.
Well, when I was growing up, that was the sport. You know, you can go coon hunting, and that's, you take the dogs out and chase them on a night when there's a big bright moon and tree them. It's really cruel, you know.
Tree
looking back, well, you get them up in the tree. Yeah.
Oh, just get them in the tree. I don't know the lingo.
Yeah. Oh my god. Yeah, and then you can use firecrackers and stuff to scare them out. It's brutal. I look back and it's shameful actually, but it was cool back then living in the country. You go coon hunting.
I think it's still cool. Well, Dad, we on this show that you're joining us on, we are doing two idioms. We've already done what is it? Not chip off the old block, because that's the one we're about to do. We've already done chip on your shoulder. Mm-hmm. And now we're gonna do chip off the old block. And it got me thinking, you know, I would say that I probably I don't feel like I'm a chip off the old block in the sense that I don't think I look like you very much. I mean, even if you look right now, it's kind of tough to see. I probably take a little more after the Logan side of things, but I recently realized there was something that I think I may have inherited from you. So I'm going to tell you a story. Well, I'm kidding. Of course, I've gotten.
No, I know what you mean.
But,
So last episode, we were doing, Steve was presenting the term, why am I blanking? What was the term?
During the discussion of the term dank.
Dank. I knew it was, I was like, was it swag? No, dank. And I was telling Steve how I had encouraged Logan because I thought that was going to be like the new cool was going to be to say dank. Yeah. And it reminded me back when we moved to Virginia Beach, when we started going to the school there, I think it was the second year, it might have been the first year, that you encouraged me to say something, try to start a new catchphrase at school.
Yeah, I remember that.
Do you? Do you remember totally. What it was? I hope I didn't get it wrong. Oh,
no, I do remember. I remember why. Because you guys were coming out with words I didn't. I was like, what the heck is this word? Psych. You know, it's like people were saying psych for stuff. Yeah. I was like, it's like psychology, psych. But, you know, it just seems kind of obvious and stupid to me. So, but now it's, you know, it's in the lingo. But yeah, so I said, God, just, you know, you want to be cool, just come up with something of your own and just get it to go, you know. Well, yeah. You know, I used to like what? And I said, well, you know, like, remember what? I don't want to.
I do.
You tell me what it was.
No. I'm nervous because if it's not what I no, it, we, it will we, be. We already have merchandise that has sold with this catchphrase and it is sweeping the nation. So if I got it wrong, so this is going to be the moment of truth. I'm
yeah,
not going to say
it's not
say
original.
It.
Yeah.
Okay. No, well, no. What do you remember it being?
It's that's what I'm talking about.
Yes.
That's what I'm talking about. That's what he'd say it. That's how he'd say it. Yeah.
That was I can't I believe you
I
remember
just was
that.
Trying to come up with something. Okay, look, something your friends would not know, probably, right. And being in whatever eighth grade.
I think it's great. And I'm sorry that your son failed you, frankly, in not getting that into the zeitgeist, because it's an awesome catchphrase.
Yeah, I've seen t-shirts.
That's right. And I have mine, Zach. I wore mine last week. Like a little kid who got like a new t-shirt and like wore it every day till like mom took it from him and washed it. And my, that's what I'm talking about. T-shirt was all over Richmond the past week.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, good.
Yeah.
That's what
so
I'm talking about.
I truly thought you wouldn't remember. So I told, I told Logan he should start doing, you know, using the term dank, which was a terrible idea because it actually ties to like drug culture. So thankfully he didn't, but I want to show, actually I should show dad a picture of the shirt. I should have thought to do that ahead of time. So, and dad, the thing is, like, I did try it. I don't know if you know that. I did. I went out. We used to play this game called Smear the Queer, which was basically like you threw a football up in the air and whoever caught it, everyone tried to hit that person. Yeah. You know, I don't think they have these games anymore. I mean, obviously you wouldn't call it that, but I don't think there are games like we had, like King of the Hill, basically games where you just tried to hurt somebody.
Yeah.
It's
important.
I'm killing time. Okay, here we go. I'm gonna share my screen so you can see this. By the way, and then I have a couple more questions, and I'm not gonna keep you super long. All right, here we go. Share screen. I am just amazed that not only do you remember, but that I remember and got it right. All right, here we go.
Great catchphrase. It resonates. Yeah.
All right, there it is. That's what I'm talking about. And I feel like that picture, that could be like any one of my classmates.
So where did this t-shirt come from? Did you?
We designed it. We had a discussion about this and you inspired me.
Okay.
You were my muse last weekend. And honestly, we recorded something. We got off the call and I went and made this. Because it touched me so much. Because I think it's awesome. Great. I think it's going to come. It's finally going to work.
Well, that's what I was going to say. Okay. Is like Steve was known at our school for being the guy that would start catchphrases and nicknames.
Oh, yeah.
Like most people's nicknames came from Steve. Also, nicknames, I do have to point out that I've done now. We're on like episode, what are we on? 138. Mm-hmm. And Steve and I have done a lot of talking. Probably the most delighted I've seen him was after hearing about that. He really took to it. So, and I do think, Steve, you do kind of feel like, do you kind of wish we could go back in time and that you could have spread that? Because it would have spread.
It would have been, it could have made that same t-shirt.
Yeah.
I don't know what technology I would have used.
But you got to say it, you know, you don't pronounce the G and the A. It's like, that's what I'm talking about. You know, you don't, there's no G on talking. And that's what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. That's why you.
Yeah. Oh yeah, I didn't. Yeah,
that's what I'm talking about.
That's what I was gonna say though. I did try. I remember either tackling some guy or making some play, and I just that's what I'm talking about because I had full faith that all I had to do was say it one time and it was gonna spread, and it didn't. But okay, so Dad, thank you for joining us to remember that. I was curious, though, before I let you go, if, you know, you were talking about the dumb slang that we had, like psych and some other, and like, I don't know, there's a lot of them. And by the way, I'm assuming that, I was talking a lot differently, you know, just because different demographics we were with, you know?
Yeah. I gotta say this. This is a little weaving way off the subject a little bit, but you thought you were so smart, about coming up with stuff. You said, hey, ask me anyway, just give me a word and I'll have a jingle or I'll have a rhyme, I'll have a comeback. And I said, oh man, give me a break. And you said, give me a break of that Kit Kat bar. You said, oh my gosh.
Like, there you go.
It's like rolled it right out. Anyway, so
I was probably more proud than I should have been that I knew that many jingles, but that's true. That was probably I probably peaked right there in that moment.
Yeah, well, but that was
when you think back to when you were a kid, did you have any other, was there any other slang that maybe has lost its way or any other phrases that, I mean, I'm putting you on the spot here, so if you don't have any, that's fine. I've got another question.
When I was a kid, mostly, there's a lot of military slang.
Go ahead, because that was going to be my follow-up.
Yeah, I mean, that's like, it's all over the place, and there's so much, it's just like a societal thing, if you're in the Army and you're a paratrooper, the people that are not paratroopers are dirty legs, or they're a leg, so you never probably hear somebody called a leg, but that, it's never used except with the word dirty in front of it, so... Yeah. That's a non-paratrooper guy. So they have wings. So they're, and then there's all the stuff that you see like on Top Gun, you know, that they tried to use and they sometimes did, but all that Navy fighter pilot jargon, you know, like six, I got your six, or there's bogey and, just all that kind of that specific, but the nickname part of it, that's the real fun part. So you know, they have call signs in the in the Navy, Air Force, and all that. Mm-hmm. And people think because they watch that movie that's what they really do. And maybe sometimes they do, but normally you get your call sign when you go out. But you have a nickname assigned. So my first fighter squadron, my flight commander immediately gave me the nickname Cold Mike. Because there's a switch in the F4, it's like front back cockpit, you know, a little toggle switch. It says Cold Mike. If you switch it to the Cold Mike position, that means when you get sick and barfing your guts out, the other guy doesn't have to listen to you. Because normally, Hot Mike, you guys can hear each other breathe constantly, you know, all that, you know. So it's only time somebody go Cold Mike was when they were smoking a cigarette or throwing up. So. So that was when he'd go Cold Mike. But anyway, so he gave me that nickname because my name was Mike. He's you're gonna be Cold Mike. You know, so
that's a great nickname, by the way.
Yeah, but you could not give yourself a nickname. There was a guy who came into a squadron when I was in, I think it was in the Philippines, whatever. He comes in, you know, he says, my nickname is War Eagle, you know, and so his name became Turkey Buzzard, you know, that was what he was. He had nobody called him War Eagle, right. So he was a Turkey Buzzard from there on out.
Anyway. That's amazing.
I think, that's a big violation of nickname code. You can never give your own nickname.
You cannot choose your own nickname. And in like some cases, people do use that for their call sign. But the call sign is kind of an official thing given out by the it changes. Day by day, you might be something one day and something else the next day. You don't have permanent call signs because that would be an intelligence breach. I mean, this in the Air Force, maybe the Navy does it. I don't know. You didn't want to be known because then the bad guys know who you are and you start getting a money or a bounty on your head if you do something like shoot down one of their guys. And anyway,
I remember seeing your helmet. I think I could be thinking of your old football helmet, but in the garage, it seems like there was an actual helmet. But I always had a picture of there being like a name because of Top Gun, like on the helmet. Yeah. I'm assuming that was
just fine. I didn't have my name on the helmet. Some guys had their name like because they would buy their helmets back in the early days of good equipment. Like Vietnam War era, they had junk, and you know, you could turn your head sideways real fast and you'd be looking at the side of your helmet because it wouldn't fit right. Then there was a company called Protection Incorporated that started, you know, building helmets, and they would make custom helmets, and guys would pay $200-$300, which was a lot of money. And it would to get their custom helmets. And then the Air Force finally caught up and they started just giving everybody custom helmets. You get fitted for it and you make a custom helmet. And so those helmets had have a little bit of a, you could put a little bit of flair on them, but you didn't want to put your name on there because, you know, if you got shot down or something, you don't want to give up information about who you are if you can help it.
That makes total sense. And it's funny you brought up Top Gun, because that was actually one of the questions I had written down. That was going to be my final question, was how much of, you know, the Top Gun movie, how faithful was it to your life? Which,
well, far,
I mean, I know really, it wasn't based on you, but
no, it's a Navy. Was it? It's a Navy deal, you know, because I was not in the Navy and they were different, but I mean, we used to fly with Navy guys sometimes. And it was by far the first movie I'd seen that actually had realistic looking flying stuff. You know, the older movies was all, I don't know, I can't say they used computer graphics because they didn't have them, but they used something.
Like model,
know,
they, like model airplanes.
Yeah, I don't know, but it was not real. But the Top Gun was amazingly realistic. So that part of it was pretty darn real, you know, but the part that really killed me was the Kelly McGillis piece where the intel officer comes in and is like, criticizing Tom Cruise's flying strategies or skills. Like, that would never happen. No, the intel guys were kind of whatever, you know, they were, you listen to them, but they didn't tell you usually. Well, I wasn't in wartime, but even in wartime, you picked up what you could, but they didn't tell you how to fly. That's ridiculous. Yeah. So they maybe gave you some kind of tip, but that was real unrealistic. And the rest of it was amazingly realistic. I thought, you know,
I remember you making a comment about them taking their masks off and stuff like that.
Oh, well, no, that flying around with their mask off, that's not realistic. Well, at least it wasn't for us. I mean, you didn't let your mask flop around while you're en route. You never know when you're going to get shot at and stuff. Mm-hmm. Plus, you had to be on cold mic while you're doing it.
Yeah.
You know, it picks up all the it picks up all the noise really well when you're take your mask off. So
yeah,
anyway,
well Dad, this has been fun. I appreciate it. I don't know if you have anything else you want to share, otherwise that was really what we wanted to get to today. So
okay, I'll stop while I'm ahead.
No, I do have one request though. On your way out, you got to hit us with one last you know what to say to take us out.
Have fun.
that's an inside joke.
Okay. Oh, that's an inside joke.
And that's what I'm talking about.
Oh, that's what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
You know, no, Steve, that's a nice little, I don't know what you call it.
It's a mustache.
Yeah, your facial hair. Looks good.
Thank you.
You guys are looking like real grown-ups, man.
It's about time. And let me know too, the next time I'm walking by, if you want to deal with those raccoons, let me know. We'll work
something out. Yeah, I'm not sure how, you know, tough to be on them.
Well, we don't want to record it, but I got some ideas I'll share with you.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
Thanks again. Thank you for coming on. I appreciate you taking some time and doing it. And my dad on.
Thank you, Mr. McGinnis. We appreciate it.
All right. Talk to you later. Bye.
Yep. Thanks.
All right. Well, that was our conversation with not just Big Mike, but Cold Mike. Mm. My dad, which I had heard that before, but it's been a while.
Yeah.
And I am just blown away that he remembers the story. And I had actually forgotten also the Kit Kat story, so that was pretty good. All right, Steve, you want to take us home?
I sure do. Thank you very much for listening to Origin of Speakcies. If you enjoy the show, please help us spread the word by liking, commenting, and subscribing on YouTube, leaving a positive review and a 5-star rating on Apple Podcasts and any eggplants if they allow you to do that. For more great content and to directly support our show, become a Speakcies supporter at patreon.com/speakcies. And if you're interested in any of the shirts that we discussed on this episode or other episodes, you can find them at speakcies.com/store, which will lead you to our TeePublic powered website.
All right, well, that's what I'm talking about, and Bob's your uncle.
Watch out for bears and Kayla's from the devil.
I got this chip on my shoulder forever. I got this chip on my shoulder forever. I got this chip on my shoulder forever. I got this chip on my shoulder forever and ever.
Speakcies.